We'll have the fruit and the flower offering now. Thank you. Merci. Wow. The flower shop, surely be happy when I'm here, huh? Thank you. Come on.
I'll just, before Master gives her lecture, I'll just take a few moments of your time and share with you some of my personal experiences after having received initiation and practiced the Quanyin method. I was a spiritual practitioner for many years before I met Master Chinghai, but none of the meditation techniques or the spiritual practices that I did gave me the spiritual satisfaction that I was looking for. Even though I put a lot of time and a lot of effort into it. A friend of mine gave me a tape of Master, and this is how I was introduced to her. And after having watched the videotape and having listened to her teachings, I realized immediately that this was the teacher that I had always been looking for. Even before initiation, Master takes care of you. It took, I had to wait several months before I was able to receive the initiation, as at that time, no initiation was being given. And so Master, knowing the sincere longing in my heart, came to me in a dream and initiated me there. Before initiation, I worked many, many long hours, and I worried about everything, and I really wasn't very happy or peaceful in my heart. And after initiation, due to the ability of concentrating better, I did things much more quickly and more efficiently. And what used to take me 2 or 3 hours now took me maybe only 1 hour to do. And I became, I really didn't worry that much about things anymore. It's not that I didn't do things well, it's just that whatever it was that I did, it didn't, if it didn't turn out the way I wanted it to turn out, that was all right too. And what happened there was my attachment to the results of whatever I did was becoming less. The other thing is that I became more, I felt a lot more love, a lot more peace and harmony in relationships and in whatever I did. And it was the kind of love that accepted people for what it, however they were, rather than for what it was that I wanted them to be. And these changes happened very quickly after the initiation. And because of that, it showed me very clearly how powerful and how effective this method of meditation was. When I'm doing work for Master, often I need guidance or help to get through a difficult situation. And if I pray inside to her, I find that I can feel her presence very strongly and her guiding me through any difficult situation. Even in a seemingly scary or frightful situation, she's there protecting you. On one occasion, I had to go to a foreign country, and this country was a third world country that I had never been to before. And when I arrived at the airport, the people that were to meet me, I discovered, weren't able to come. And so there I was at 7 o'clock at night, and in a strange country, not knowing the language and having to find a hotel. And what happened was a few minutes later, the lady who was sitting next to me on the airplane came and asked me if I had people to meet me. And I said no, so she offered to drive me to a hotel. So this lady was kind of like an angel that fell out of the sky that Master had sent to help me out of this difficult situation. And also in my 2 years in living in Maoli, I had many encounters with snakes, big snakes, cobras. Some of them are thin and quite long, and some fat and short. And one day I went to wash my hands, and underneath the sink was hidden this not too fat but quite long cobra. And as I went to turn the water on, it raised its head and started to hiss. And so I stopped for a second and then stepped back, and of course I didn't get bitten. And there were many cases, situations like that. And the point is that sometimes you cannot anticipate the situation and you don't have time to pray for help. And even in those situations, she protects you and takes care of you. On another occasion, when I was distributing sample booklets, one gentleman was asking about the meditation technique and who Master was, and I was explaining to him, but he didn't like what I was saying because it didn't seem to suit his understanding of what was being said in the Bible. So he became very angry, and at that time he was about to hit me. I felt like there was a wall of protection around me, and he never did hit me. And these qualities, these are some of the qualities of a living saint or a fully realized being, and those of omnipresence and omnipotent and omniscience. And omnipresence means that they can be in any place at any time, and in many places at the same time. And omnipotent means that they're all powerful, and omniscient means that they're all hearing. So not all spiritual masters have these qualities, and not all spiritual masters are true living masters. But when you need help and guidance, and you pray to Master, she can hear your prayers no matter where you are or regardless of the situation. And when, if you've had any personal experience of this, then you know, you feel more relaxed and comfortable and very happy and peaceful, because you know that you're protected and well taken care of. Those who have practiced this method and have practiced or practiced other methods and then have practiced the Kuan Yin method realize that Master Qinghai is a true living master, and that she is the best and the greatest and the highest being to ever have graced this earth. And I'll stop there, and perhaps Stephen can introduce a little bit about Master Qinghai's background.
Thank you, Vicky. I just wanted to add that she's also the most beautiful. And I'd like to turn this over at this moment to Master Qinghai.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Thank you all for coming today. I'm also very honored to be in this great country, the country of prosperity, of peace, of loving kindness, and humanitarian, because your country has what many countries do not have, the warmth and the human love between each other, as well as a very elevated spiritual standard. I was very touched to know that in your country there's no death sentence, and that shows that in this land only love rules above all things. And let's hope that other countries will learn from your example. To let God rule the justice, and not to take revenge. Also, I have the opportunity to speak to some of the people who live in this land, the immigrants, for example, and the Vietnamese refugees who have been welcomed into your country with love and non-discrimination. And they are very happy in this country. And I'm sure this will add more merit and blessing into the great nation that you happen to reside. Only a very spiritual, elevated country can possess such quality of loving kindness, of non racial, non-discriminating quality. And if every nation is like this, at least our world will become a small paradise. But unfortunately, there are many other things that prevent people to understand the basic truth. That is, love is the greatest law in the universe. And therefore, many people do not enjoy life the way they should. The more we cling to life in a forceful way, the less we can enjoy the flavor of it. Therefore, the enlightened person are happier, more contented. And even then, from this very stable state of mind, they can do many wonders because they are quiet enough to understand where their wisdom lies, where their greatness is, in order to make use of it. When we are very busy, or we are in a panic, or in a hurry, most often we forgot what we want to do, or we do things in an incomplete way. Therefore, a tranquil mind of an enlightened person can see things more clearly, and that's the only logic of this science. Be still and know that I am God. Who is that I am? That is the one that resides within us. That is the true self. Therefore, we are God. This realization doesn't come through hearing people saying that, or through believing alone, but through self-realization. And just as any other science, there must be a special technique. Everything we learn and we master in life, all done through self-experimenting. Similarly, enlightenment can be achieved through perseverance, self-experiencing, and therefore it will be lasting. That's the reason why we have heard a lot of saints and sages of all time saying that God is within us. If God is within us, mean we and God are one. And if we and God are one, we are God. But even then, we heard so often, and we read so many Bibles and so many statements from such great men like Jesus and Buddha, Muhammad, etc. But we would not truly believe that we are that. And we could not find the God that's supposed to dwell within ourselves. It is because we lack self-experience. We have not known it by our own discovery, but only by hearing. In the old time, when science has not reached the height of today, we have many problems. Even the rain will trouble us. Even the snow will bother us. Anything, any small thing, big things, obstruct our daily activities. Even the rain, for example. Now we have umbrella. We have raincoat. We can walk in the rain. We can enjoy even the rain. And we can work in the rain. Better still, we have car, we have buses, we have all things that protect us from the different weather changes in the nature. Therefore, we are very comfortable. In the ancient time, if we were to hold a meeting today, and many of you stay in a very, very long distance, could not be here. Not because of the distance only, but because of rain, because of weather and all that. So in the ancient time, people hid themselves in caves, in mountains, under the trees, to protect themselves from natural disadvantages. And many people still do today in some of the undeveloped country. So that must not be. Enlightenment is like that. It's like the more just like we add more comfort into our life and be happy in whatever condition. Suppose we don't have raincoat, we don't have umbrella, we don't have car. If it rains today, we are stopped from all our activities, from all the things that we love to do and want to accomplish. Is that not so? Yes. Similarly, life is fantastic. If we have enlightenment, there is nothing in this life which could be named suffering or terror or trouble only because we lacked protection, that there seems to be so. Because take example of the rain. If it doesn't rain, we don't have water, and all the trees, the flowers cannot grow, and all the crops that we need for survival will never be there. Therefore, rain is not terrible in itself, but it is if we don't have umbrella and we walk miles in the cold. We will shiver, we will catch cold, we will be ill, and we may lose our life even. Through such a very harmless and useful nature phenomena, even very nature, beautiful phenomena become harmful to us if we lack equipment to protect ourselves. Therefore, many people want to change the world, to change the way we live our life. But the sage of enlightened spirit say, no, change yourself. Because if we change ourselves, we change the world around us. Even if the world still stays the way it is, we are not affected. And if each person changes in this way, there's no need for any war, and there will be no disaster. If everyone has umbrella, raincoats, what is the need to change the season, to stop the rain, or to make the magical power to control the raining time, like many people would like to learn? And many people possess this magical power, can stop the rain, can make it lengthen, can make it can push it to another direction. And it takes a long time to learn this magical skill. But why bother? Why bother? We just wear the raincoat. It's cheap, it's simple, and everyone can use it. Once the Buddha went to cross the river on boat, and the boatman did not want to take him because he had no money. At that time he was, of course, a renunciate, a monk still, who possessed no property. So the Buddha had no choice but to walk over the river. Yes. These days, quite a few yogis in India and Tibet and elsewhere still can do that. Many people ask me about the magical power, because people are curious about things that they cannot explain, and also about things that they scientifically think is impossible. So I told them that yes, these things still exist, but nevertheless, it's not to be used at random, and also not to be done for show. Even Jesus, he possessed a lot of magical power, but he didn't always do it. He was very reluctant. Therefore, he raised only one dead person to life. He cured maybe only two or three blind persons, and not run around all the time and raise all the dead to life. That will bring the nature law into chaotic nature. And that is the thing an enlightened saint would not do. Each one has to learn to yearn within his heart to know himself, to know God. And then the kingdom of God will come. And the master will come to help that person. If we use magical power or any other supernatural way to convince people, we unknowingly lead people astray, because we limit God power within these magical skills, which could be learned by some expert. And also, by doing that, we interfere with the flow of nature. And of course, we bring some disaster upon ourselves. Because what we seek is the eternal thing, like wisdom, love, and the greatness of the universal power. Not the small corner of this low level of game. But when we possess great wisdom, we also possess numerous miraculous power. But at that time, we have so much, too much, that we might not even know how much we have. And things just come out from us automatically without us intentionally doing anything. That's why the saints do things without doing, without even thinking, without even wanting to do it. It's just like a very, very rich person. He has no idea how much he has. He can never count, he can never see enough all of his treasure. Therefore, the enlightened person are always happy, at least most of the time happy. And even when he encounters unhappiness, which is brought to him by his very close contact with someone he loved, maybe, then he is affected. Because of the love for that person, he may share the suffering or unhappiness of that person. But even then, he is very, very calm inside. And he knows that the unhappiness is only ephemeral nature. He's not dragged and sunk into this unhappiness, like most of the people do. Therefore, if we even want just to be happy in this life, we should get enlightenment. Of course, I should tell you, the great people of Canada, that you have to seek God because for God's sake alone, not because of happiness in this life. But I do think that these things come together. If you are enlightened, you are happy. And the more happy, the more you believe in enlightenment, and the more you will appreciate God nature, anyhow. What is the use of expecting an everlasting happiness in heaven while we go over here in darkness and in misery every minute of our life? An enlightened person enjoy both worlds, enjoy heaven at the same time as enjoy the world. Why? Because he knows that whatever is manifested in this world is also the will of heaven, and is also a copy of the real manifestation in the higher kingdom of God. And because he's very relaxed, has no fear, no anxiety, so whatever he enjoys to the utmost. Many people think that after enlightenment, maybe you don't know how to love your wife anymore, or to love your husband or children anymore. It is the opposite. Only when you are very happy and know your true worth, can you truly love other person. Because you see her reflection, your reflection within her. You will respect that person and love all the good qualities that God endows on that person. Because you have realized what God has given yourself. And then you know God gives all beings the same amount of quality. But we choose sometimes to go into the opposite direction. And therefore, we suffer. And then we blame God. We say, how come God has such almighty power and cannot turn this paradise into heaven? The power doesn't lie in God's hand, it lies in your hand. I know all this through experience, not through books and not through any Bible. And I know this also through the experiences in the life of my disciples. And that is also the reason why we see each other today. It is due to the kindness of my disciples. They want to share with you what they have discovered. So they have gone through a lot of trouble and expenses and time consuming to organize this day as a congregation. We do not do this with the very burning ambition to convince you into our path. But we do it with a very happy attitude of just a happy person. Therefore, we do not care to wear very special, renunciating dress to impress you. We do not try to make a very holy appearance of ourselves to convert you. We do not try to give anything to you, gift or any other kind of magical power to let you come into our circle. But we do it as the duty of a brother to another brother. And we just do it for the sake of doing it, actually. We're happy whether you convince or not convince. We'll be contented whether you come or you go. Because nothing is that deadly serious to us anymore. We do it or not do it is the same thing to us. I could be sitting pretty on top of the mountain in Taiwan and enjoying my samadhic power, or I could be sitting here knowing more of the people of the earth planet, is the same to me. Therefore, if you feel that you're ready for this happiness, which is the true happiness, because it comes from the root, because you know the whole thing, from heaven to earth and hell, you know everything, and then you choose what you would like to enjoy. Therefore, your happiness will be true and lasting. Otherwise, most of the so-called enjoyment in this world, we are not free to choose. Sometimes we are dragged along to a party and try to enjoy it. Sometimes we are forced to get married because of some political or business reason and try to make the best out of it. Sometimes we drag along with the big family and trying to feed them, working from morning till night, and try to think that we are great because we're taking care of the family. But it's not always the choice. Therefore, we do not feel happy in many things we do, because somehow we feel that we are not the one who control all this. We are not the host. We are just like a guest. We are blown with the wind and go along with whatever situation. We lose many interest and joy in life through not knowing why we are doing all this and that. But after enlightenment, it's different. Whatever we enjoy, we truly enjoy. We understand the value of life as well as the value above this life. There are two lives in any planet. One is of the material existence, the other is of everlasting nature. If we know only one and we lack the other, just like most of people in the world, they enjoy only the material existence of so-called life, but they do not know the real picture of this projection. They know only the shadows, so they enjoy the material life and fear to lose it. But the truly enlightened person knows both, the everlasting and also the copy of it. And he can enjoy both at the same time. Or he can choose to enjoy one or not the other. Or he can choose to enjoy both. But I think while we are already here, we might just well enjoy. And there's nothing in this world that we should not enjoy, really, except those that is harmful to the lives of other beings. Therefore, we just suggest a vegetarian diet. So the fish can always swim in the sea as much as he pleases. And the cow can gaze on the pasture until nature calls him back to where he belongs. And we can enjoy them, and they can enjoy us. Yeah. Some of the enlightened persons, I don't know how to which degree, but they choose to live in the inside, in the other side of life. Yeah. The spiritual side of life. And therefore, give the impression to the people that all the enlightened person has to be like that, has to go into the Himalaya, has to go into the cave, has to forsake all the beautiful things about this life in order to be a Buddha. But that must not be so. Because we will be too aloof from this world. And many people find it difficult to associate with us. And if they find it too difficult to associate with us, how can they help themselves? How can they know what we know? Of course, maybe it is more pleasant for a saint or an enlightened person to stay away from the hustle bustle of the world and to be carefree in his or her own way. But on the other hand, there are many other brothers and sisters who need our assistance. Everything in this world is of some use. And if an enlightened sage became a useless being, then it is a waste of nature's product. Therefore, we should just stay in the world but remain above it. We can have our house, our cars, but we no longer are slave to these possessions. If we have them, we enjoy them. If we don't have them, we just don't. It's a very simple life. I have beautiful cars when I went to Taiwan. But I just sold them before I went on world tour because we were a little bit short of the airplane ticket. So I sold them, yeah. And in the future, should I have any more of these beautiful and expensive cars, it'd be fine. I go on bus, yeah. My disciples have many cars. I can go with them, yeah. No problem. I can borrow one day from this person and next day another person. Why should I have my own car anyhow? Yeah. Therefore, the things in this world we will enjoy if they are there, and if they're not there, makes no difference to us. That is the way of the enlightened spirit. Not that we have to run away from material existence, but we remain above it. And I think that is more practical for most of the people on this planet, because we are in the material surrounding. We are in the material existence. Wait until we leave this physical world, we can enjoy completely the spiritual atmosphere of the real life. So why be in a hurry? If everyone get enlightenment and run into the Himalaya and stay there forever, and then soon we have no more enlightened person left. And the other would never know of enlightenment, right? Because everyone's gone. No connection, no message, no example. No one who walks beside us, who share with us all the ups and downs of the world, who encourages us to walk in life as angel, as God. In the old days, it's very difficult to know where the master is, who is the enlightened person. People have to climb mountains, cross the sea, in a lot of hardship and trouble in order to find an enlightened person. Therefore, our world has not developed in the ancient time. People lived in poverty, in lack of a lot of comforts. So I think that is not very ideal. I think the enlightened person must live in this world, must do whatever he has to do, must take care of whomever God placed in his hands, and be happy, be enlightened. Because even if we run away into the forest, we can't run away from the universe. We are still in there. Where did we run away to? Right? So what's the nonsense? Many people think an enlightened person must have a very special appearance, maybe a very long beard. I happen not to have one anyhow. But today, with the technical, I'll say, advancements, I think I can grow a bear even, yeah, right? With some chemical stuff, yeah. Or maybe an enlightened person has to just stay in the Himalaya. Yeah, there are some, maybe some enlightened person who stays in the Himalaya, but it must not be like that. Must not be all of them like that. I don't want to cite Bibles or scriptures anymore, otherwise we'll be in trouble. I just talk what I know. Forget about the scriptures. I was going to cite Buddhist scriptures for you, but I thought, better not. The less you know, the better. The more simple, yeah? And then you don't add more complicated intellectual, nonsense into your brain, because the Bibles cannot enlighten us. The menu cannot satisfy our hunger. Therefore, what we need is the direct teaching. Of course, there are two kinds of teaching. One is the theoretical doctrine, which comes from the masters while the masters were still alive. That is to teach his disciples about how to behave in the society. This is just for the mind and just to suit the customs and law of that nation at that particular period of time. And also to correct some of the bad habits of the disciples and to guide them in many, for example, many aspects in life like political, business, marriage, and things like that. But these are all worldly, all within the level of material existence. There is another teaching, which is the real one, the original and the lasting. This teaching is non-verbal, and that can be done through what we call thought transference, when the disciples turn inward and listen to the teaching from heaven. At the time of initiation, we will tell you how to do that. And not because we tell you that you can do that, but because you are ready for it. And the master power will switch on the button of your age-old wisdom, which lays dormant within yourselves, life after life, until now. Just like we switch on the light, and all the darkness will disappear instantly. That is immediate enlightenment process. And that is very possible for everyone who is sincere and who wants to know how great he is and how he connects with the whole universe, how God dwells within himself that he doesn't know all this time. And then everything else in life will take care of itself, truly. I ask all of my disciples, none of them says that they are not happier than before, that they are not more contented than before, that they are not more intelligent than before, that they are not more capable, more powerful than before. Even just a few weeks afterward, or even a few days afterward, depends on the person, depends on how receptive that person is. Just even after initiation, just a few minutes, even within initiation, you know you changed forever. And you accelerate. You're no longer within human standard, but you enter the circle of sainthood without changing any appearance, without running away to anywhere, without doing anything dramatical in your life. Just to be where we are and enjoy both worlds. Enjoy the real and as well as the ephemeral nature of the projection of the real life. That's what we have discovered. That's what we continue to discover, and that's what we like to share with you. Thank you for your loving attention.
Now, if you have any questions, please print them clearly on the pieces of paper that you've been given. And people will come up and down the aisles and collect the questions. We'll translate that.
Yeah.
Grant your Chinese or Vietnamese or Spanish, whatever language that is your...
It's your best, you write it, and we translate.
First question is...
Vous pouvez écrire en français si anglais non possible. S'il vous plaît.
First question is, why do we need enlightenment? Is it because we desire continued existence, or is it merely our lack of understanding of life and death and its elaborate illusion? Thank you. I bid you peace.
I have talked so much, and you still ask this question? Why do we need enlightenment? Anyone knows? Have you absorbed? Yeah, you talk about it. Why do we need enlightenment, brother? Yeah, you, yeah. What?
So we can know ourselves as God.
Yeah. A man who doesn't know himself lacks everything. We want to know so many things, but we don't know who we are and why we're here and what we do. And I think The way of a gentleman is at least to know ourselves, yeah? And then we can say, we can know every other thing. If not, it's funny, no? It's funny that you don't know where your house is and you know all the houses in the country. Okay.
Okay. Why is it necessary to cease another meditation practice to learn the Kuan Yin method?
No, it's not necessary. If you are already contented within your practice, if you're happy with it, if that makes your life more fruitful, more loving, and more more expanded in wisdom, you think your path is correct, and you have found the light of heaven, and you have heard the direct teaching from heaven within yourself, then you don't need to seek this method, okay? Only when you don't have it, and you're welcome to come.
What do you think should be done about hatred, violence in everyday life? Example, prejudice and racial discrimination, or how to get the message to those who don't want to listen?
I think all these phenomena are the result of non-enlightened mind. If we are enlightened, everything is solved without having to speak with each other, without having to preach at all. So actually, all these things, just as anger, hatred, greed and all that, came from the lack of enlightenment in that person, because he's so unsatisfied with what we have, what he has in life, so uncontented within the framework of his life. So it becomes natural that he's agitated, he's aggressive, he's angry, he's greedy for more, because he thinks these things will satisfy him more, make him more happy.